Hi, I'm Brad Paul. Welcome to the Acoustic Cafe. This is where we bring you the best in contemporary folk music. I'd like to introduce my guest, Greg Greenway. Hi, Greg.
How you doing?
Pretty good, and yourself?
I'm doing fine.
Glad you could make it by.
Yes, on such a lovely afternoon.
Yeah, it's a beautiful...
Sweltering Wakefield afternoon.
98 degrees.
Complete with insects.
100% humidity.
Yes.
But we're in the climate-controlled...
That's right.
...sealed studio.
That is correct. Yeah, this reminds me of Virginia, where I'm from. This whole 95 degrees, 98 degrees, 90% humidity. That's why I live in Boston now.
Yeah, so you could get away from all that.
That's right. And now here it is, followed me up to Wakefield. So,
when I first saw you performing, I think it was at the Nameless Coffee House, probably about 1979 or 80.
Right.
And since then, you've been continuing to perform in a variety of different settings, solo, duo, trio, full band.
Correct. Mormon Tabernacle Choir. Everything. Yeah, it's been, since the first time I scared to death went to the Nameless Coffee House, I guess that's, you're about right, 79. I'd come up from Virginia and I thought everybody in Boston was Bob Dylan. And I went to the Nameless and auditioned, and it was the night that they were training six managers. So I sat there and played totally petrified in front of six people with notebooks. You know, and so I played four songs, felt miserable, and they were it was kind of like, we'll call you. And I went, man, well, there it is. I'm going back to Virginia, a complete failure. And fortunately, call me back. And just about everything that I've done in music in Boston or in the New England area, anywhere for that matter, came from going to the Nameless Coffee House. And it was there that I lost my stage fright, you know, little monumental things like that. And from there, someone saw me and got me to do a show at Passim. And those days, you could get on the Sunday radio shows. There would be the two acts, and they'd add another person to fill up the rest of the time. And I got my courage up, went in and talked to Bob, and said, I think I deserve a chance to play, you know. And he's pretty inscrutable, that guy. And,
And he's a hard nut to crack.
He is, but you know, I really liked him for it though.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, well, yeah, you do. You deserve a chance. And it's like one little sentence like that, you know, it changes your life. And it's sort of an internal thing, you know, because you walk out in the middle of the city and there's millions of lives going on around you.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this just little happiness, but in front of Bob, you can't be real happy, you know. You can't act like, whoopee, whoopee, you know, you can't do that. So I kind of was like vibrating in one spot and just kind of vibrated up the steps out into the alleyway behind the coop and vibrated down the street. And for some reason, I bought two brandy glasses. I don't know why, it was just some weird thing.
So you can home and celebrate with a glass of brandy.
I guess, I didn't know anybody, but it just felt right or something. But that's, everything started from there, essentially. And
well, from that point, you, as I mentioned earlier, grew to different ensembles.
Yeah.
Has your songwriting changed a great deal from being a solo artist to fit?
The thing that has changed,
different
Fred,
formats?
The thing that has changed has been the instruments you use.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I'm concerned, songwriting, no matter who it is, it sits down. As far as I'm concerned, it's a human being playing to other human beings. And what it is, it's taking something that you feel very strongly and very powerfully about and communicating that. And I think more than anything, what happened to me is, I told you before the show, I love drums.
Mm-hmm.
And rhythmic things. So one of the first acoustic influences I ever had was Richie Havens, who went out and performed with a bass player and a conga player.
Yeah.
And right alongside him was an Ola Tunji album in my house.
Mm-hmm.
So it was one of those deals where we'd go to Passim and I'd bring a bass player the next time, and the next time I'd bring a drummer, and the next time the drummer would bring a conga drum, and then he'd bring a floor tom, and then a cymbal, and pretty soon Bob was standing at the door kind of you know, looking at us like, wait a minute, what's going on here? So really what it's been for me is I've really been increasing my vocabulary musically.
Mm-hmm. Have you learned other instruments?
Yeah, I felt like the key instrument to, I'm totally self-taught, so when you're playing with people who know what they're doing, it's like being completely illiterate. So I felt like the key to all music was the piano, which is just a graphic depiction of the musical scale, and you can play the bass with your left hand, you know, much to the bass player's chagrin later on, but it's just the key to understanding how music fits and how it works together, and that's what it's been for me in the last 5 or 6 years. It's been an education of how to use instruments, but as far as writing songs, the difference is, it's all in where you're going with it. It's mm-hmm. like you start with exactly the same thing.
They draw on the same influences and yeah, same subject matter.
Well, yeah, and it's like the more powerful the emotion, like you're able to express. To me, when I feel angry, which is a lot of the time for some reason, I'm a very calm person generally, and to other people I'm that way, but there's a lot of things inside of me that accumulate and come out when I'm writing. It's just a part of my personality that has to happen, otherwise I'm sure I'd be an axe murderer or something. So this is remedial.
But the release.
Yeah, this is it. And so you can just, there are pieces of music that just defy saying what it is. And I think most of the influences I have now, people I listen to, are people who just defy terms anyway. Mm-hmm. You know, so I never felt of myself as a folk musician, a rock musician. I've always felt of myself as a musician. And fortunately, the guys I play with, particularly Doug Ray, the bass player that I used to play with all the time, well, I still play with all the time, we've both sat and talked about this. It's a lifetime thing,
yeah.
Understanding music and understanding the thousands of points of view. It's a sort of way of being an anthropologist. It's a language beyond language.
Yeah.
And as I was telling you, I walked past a Dixieland band the other day in the Prudential Center, and I was amazed. You know, it was a form that totally escaped me before, but I saw it, and it was so remarkable. There were four guys there that were in their, you know, late 60s and 70s, and they were all relating to each other, and they played this music, and people actually got up out of the crowd and came up and sang with them. It was a language. This guy who was 80 was sitting on the bench over there. He got up and danced with a woman who was just walking by. I mean, it was this thing. It's this language.
That's great.
That escapes and translates to all people across all lines you could think of. And that's what brings me to music. You know, it's that thing. It's not a label. It's like, let's get to what really matters here.
Well, let's get to it then. Shall
we? Right. What a segue.
Sounds good.
For that. Right. This is a song called Without a Prayer, written just recently when I was sitting in my living room and having the news, which is a pretty remarkable occurrence. You can have things like Tiananmen Square in China and Beijing brought right into your living room. And it makes quite an impact.
Everybody, what's that shouting all about? It's just more bad news, just another preacher, just another lost cause, crying out, crying out. Have taken what I was given, what any other man would do. Never asked too many questions. That was never good enough. For you. See, I'm just, you see, just an open wound. What about justice? What about freedom? Gotta stand up. What's fair is fair. There are just too many people out there. No matter what you do, you take a side. Wait a minute, what am I seeing? What am I seeing from Tiananmen Square? Oh, I see people standing up to tanks and guns. I see my face in anyone of theirs. Tell about justice, telling me about freedom. Stand up for what's fair is fair.
Thank you. And now I descend into weird tunings. This next song is it's pretty sappy. That's what it is. I mean, after you get political, you have to have a little sap in there to kind of balance things off, you know. This is the first girlfriend I had. This is about the first girlfriend I had in Boston. She was from Nashville, Tennessee. And she was this really, really very, very free person. And here I was, I came up from Virginia, and I was in the city, and I was extremely petrified, as a matter of fact. I didn't know anybody, and she was so free and so happy, and had a big influence on me. And she was a piano player. She was one of those people who was a scholarship person at BU, and they practiced 27 hours a day. And she essentially got kind of burnt out from it. And here I came up from Virginia, you know, six strings, and I'm dangerous. And I just couldn't understand, you know, why someone would lose the joy in what they're doing. And so one day I forced her to go in the piano room over at MIT. And she played for me, and I could not believe it. It was just, it was such an extension of her. She was so good. And we had this wonderful thing. Some people call it relationships. I prefer a thing. Well, she did the best thing for our thing. She moved to St. Louis, actually. Raised the whole tone of the thing. And the good part of it was, this is where the set begins. She called me up one night, and she'd gotten a baby grand piano in her room in St. Louis, and she played me some Scarlatti fugues over the phone. These are the most gorgeous things. And so I went right to my guitar and wrote this sap-filled piece of music.
Tennessee sat down at her piano. Her hands are there, so gently and light. With faraway eyes, she stared into the dimness and played me a day in her life. Boats on a crystal green lake in Kentucky. Sails unfurled and swollen in the wind. And of the freedom she felt in the space all around her, and the feeling of life rushing in. Tennessee, things go so quickly now. You turn your head and the days just pass you by. There's so little time and so much confusion. People don't know
This is the painful part. It gets better from here. Just have to make it through this. It'll be fine. This next song I wrote a long time ago, and sadly enough, it's still appropriate. I saw a show called 2020. It was about Johannesburg, South Africa. It showed the blacks lining up to get into the city, and they had to show their passes to this guy who was dressed up like a stormtrooper. This is the first I'd seen of this. This is long as before. Long before it was a hip thing to be anti-apartheid.
I have heard to walk the streets of Johannesburg. And it is written into law, one living thing is better than another. As a child, I sang a children's song about a country far from wrong. Now I sing of elaborate chains held together with American names. Isn't that just right? What do you know that you won't tell me about those dying to be free? What do you know? No matter where you put an iron hand, there's always space between your fingers. Oh, 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 oh. What do you know that you won't tell me about those dying to be free? What do you know that you won't tell?
Thank you. This last song, you guys have been really a wonderful audience. Not just a fly-by-night audience, a wonderful audience. This next song, and it takes courage to end with a sad song. I want you to remember me as a performer with guts, okay? So I'm from Virginia, as I said, and it took a maverick like me to write the Massachusetts State song. And it's kind of a sappy, sad song, but you know, I live in Boston now. I hear the roar of the Red Sox game. I drive down that Mass Pike, I see the Prudential Center off in the distance, and I get that lump in my throat, you know? I'm coming home, home to Massachusetts. So I think this is the state song. My apologies to Arlo Guthrie and all the school children that wrote in for him. This is it. And it is a sad song.
The highway brought me here from so far away. My only thought on that day was to survive. Especially since I'd have to drive in Massachusetts. Oh! What the hell is a rotary? What are these people trying to do to me? I was almost killed by my own courtesy. On the first day I knew I was done, when I was sideswiped by Attila the Hun. In passing he cast aspersions on my ancestry. Every morning until 9:30, it's an urban demolition derby. The winner lives to try again that night. Oh, and just to make it more of a sport, they leave potholes the size of foreign imports. They take down the signs, just ignore the traffic lights.
Look, every taxi driver I have seen puts me to mind of Charles Manson on Halloween.
12 hours in traffic, what a way to go. If you can find a place to park in the snow, if your car hasn't been stolen or towed, you're gonna love that halfway house of the road.
Thank you all very much.